Harper Audio presents Stop Whining, Start Living by Dr. Laura Schlessinger. Read by Lily LoBianco. Copyright 2008 by Dr. Laura Schlessinger. Production copyright 2008 by HarperCollins Publishers. Preface and introduction read by Dr. Laura Schlessinger.
I have spent my whole career striving to help people do and be their best and claim joy from the struggle that is life. The irony is that the struggle to be happy has been a lifelong difficult one for me too. I have come, though, to see that this has been a blessing, since my struggles have helped me understand and motivate others, and the helping of others has fed back into my experiencing joy in life. I have written many books covering just about every aspect of interpersonal and intimate relationships. This book is different. It's about your relationship with yourself and a coming to terms with the limitations of life and the acceptance of opportunities for great peace and happiness. Simply put, you have to decide for whom you are dancing through life and why. Are you still trying to get a mommy or a daddy to love or approve of you? That was my ballet, and it led me to constantly look for new challenges to prove my worth with the frustration of never finding what was ultimately impossible. Love through success. Are you not dancing at all, lest you be criticized or rejected for not dancing well enough? Are you dancing with new partners every moment because you crave the feeling of that first touch? Are you dancing roughly, stepping on others' feet, hoping to remedy your hurts by delivering even greater ones? These and more are some of the themes of this book. My goal is that even before you get through the introduction, you'll tear up, let down your guard, and open your heart to the prospect of making your life more of a pleasure to yourself and to others. Stop Whining, Start Living by Dr. Laura Schlessinger. Introduction. You are what you do. First do good, then feel good. Quote from one of my listeners, there is, I believe, no such thing as unconditional self-acceptance. Those who say so are promulgating a pernicious lie. One must first live a decent, honorable, and productive life. Only then do you get to feel good about yourself. Seeking to heedlessly gratify your desires or impulses of the moment to do things, or fail to do things, your conscience knows to be contrary to your standards of right, worthy, and virtuous behavior is, in a mental, emotional, and spiritual sense, akin to spending capital that you have not earned, and therefore will eventually cause you to feel quite negative about who and what you are. You cannot in the long run have your cake and eat it too. The longer you behave in certain ways, the more it comes to define you, not only to others, but also to yourself. Robert, one of my listeners, sent that to me with a note that said, "Thank you for helping me to learn this lesson of life. It makes me quite proud to read and hear that folks have learned certain values from me that have given their lives some contentment, direction, or purpose. I have long thought that the ultimate meaningfulness of our lives comes from fulfilling our obligations to others. For most of us, others means friends, family, or colleagues. But what if, as in the case of Robert and me, you are total strangers? How does one become obligated to a stranger? Well, who is a stranger? Is it the person behind you in line at the grocery store or the gas pump? A stranger to whom you owe nothing? Does that mean you are free to take advantage of your opportunity to dominate his or her time and resources or be otherwise disdainful? Some people seem to get an actual rush from those stolen moments of pseudo-importance and power. All strangers, though, are people just like you. Have you seen the commercial where individuals see strangers doing good deeds and in their turn do something for another, and so it keeps going? Not knowing someone's name doesn't mean you don't matter to them or they to you. Look at every human being as an opportunity to advance humanity and add something positive to the resume of your life. Does that moment's emotional high from the anonymous win of one-upsmanship last? No, it generally doesn't. By the time you get home or to work, you're probably in a worse mood. Why? Ugly sentiments breed uglier feelings, and the inevitable downward spiral continues. Too many people think that feeling good comes from competition, from beating someone else out for something, be it a parking space or an inheritance, or gaining an edge over someone, be they siblings, coworkers, even spouses, and your own children. These are mentalities that drive people deeper into despair, because although these wins might mean momentary glee, the deeper needs for admiration, love, and respect are never met. You cannot demand or grab love or respect. Demanding it will result only in resentment, fear, or dislike, even hatred. Grabbing it will not satiate your innermost desires for loving connections, given openly and without reservations. And that which you grab or demand will not have the mirror on the wall reflect back what you need to see. You don't deserve anything you haven't earned. And a lot of what you get, that is challenging, unpleasant, or horrific, wasn't earned either. The key to a satisfying life is to strive toward the former and survive the latter with your humanity intact. And that, my friends, is not easy. John, another listener, wrote, "Long ago I discovered that life is a day-to-day process. Life has its BMW, bitch, moan, and whine days, and its days of joy. The bumper sticker, S, beep, beep, T, happens, is a reflection of reality. One of God's little jokes is that you don't get pretty flowers without feeding them the proper amount of excrement. Not too much and not too little. I found that the quality of my life very much depends on what I focus on and the environment that I choose. It is difficult to be negative when you make the choice to be around positive people. The key is choice. Are there days of profound depression? In my life, yes. Then I hear one of my trainers shout, Goya, G-O-Y-A. Get off your anatomy and do something about it. Sometimes doing something about it takes support, and sometimes I can do it on my own. Open up the newspaper or turn on your computer any day, and you will find page after page and blog after blog about death, mayhem, murder, betrayal, vicious reputation and personal attacks, lies, dirty politics, injustice, Hollywood stars undermining our government, ethnic cleansing, assassinations of the innocent, daily rapes and murders of mothers and children, hurricanes, tornadoes, and earthquakes claiming lives in some instant, dictators fomenting terror, and the like. It makes one wonder, what is there to be happy about? Well, Patricia submitted her answer to my radio program. My mother and father-in-law taught me that life is for the living and we should never whine about how bad we had it or have it. They lived through the Depression and my mother-in-law had 3 bouts of cancer and is still alive and cancer-free but in a nursing home with macular degeneration, osteoporosis, and angina. But every time we visit, she asks about our day. What's new? How is the weather? Never complains about anything. She is 88 and still conquering. My father-in-law died 2 years ago with Alzheimer's. Until the end, even when he could hardly swallow, he kept trying to help. If you came to visit, he put his drink up and pushed it toward you, offering you the drink, still in some way trying to be of use. He was 86 when he died peacefully with his son and myself by his side. His funeral was the best attended I'd ever seen, with people talking about how he always helped them and total strangers who were in need. God bless. When I first read Patricia's letter, I choked up. Quite frankly, it is truly difficult to imagine being the slightest bit easy to get along with, cheerful about anything, caring about anyone, when you're suffering so much. When I'm confronted on my radio program by a caller who is clearly going through a non-voluntary hell, asking me why they should even bother with anyone or anything, I fall back onto 2 flowers from the cesspool of the Holocaust. The righteous Gentiles, Christians who risked their lives and those of their children and relatives to save Jews from the Nazi death camps, and the known acts of compassion by concentration camp victims who shared their last scrap of food with someone who was soon to die anyway, or who tried to observe their religious rituals in an environment which would seem to deny the divine. You would think that in these circumstances, personal survival would be paramount, and of course it is, but not to the exclusion of what makes that survival meaningful, one's humanity and compassion for others, which ultimately precludes anyone from being a stranger. Our country is putting the lives of American military personnel at risk to liberate people from tyranny, in the hopes of building democracies that respect their neighbors and the value of life. ultimately protecting Americans. Our police and firefighters put their lives on the line every day to protect the innocent. There are no strangers, just opportunities for blessings. Blessings, though, which come at a price. Sometimes that price is quite difficult to handle. Most of the time, though, people underestimate their ability to face pain. You can't watch 5 minutes of television without seeing an ad for some medication for the quick eradication of pain, physical or emotional. A profound clinical depression may be medical, but sadness, fear, disappointment, embarrassment, loss, frustration, etc., are just a part of normal life and need to be endured as a feeling and approached with solutions where possible. Rebecca commented on this issue in her email. You took a call from a 23-year-old struggling with life's relatively minor disappointments and was using antidepressants to cope. You asked her how she was going to deal with really hard things. You also commented on how her generation has grown up thinking sadness is a disease. I wanted to tell you I fully agree with your opinion on this. On July 10th, 2007, I went in for a routine prenatal appointment. I was 10 weeks pregnant. I went by myself and my husband was at home watching our two girls. It was at this appointment I learned my baby had died. My baby died at 9 weeks, 3 days, on July 4th. I have seared on my brain the picture of my baby perfectly still with no heartbeat. When I close my eyes, it's all I can see. On July 13th, I had a DNC because my body failed to miscarry my baby. This sent me into a tailspin. On July 21st, I went in for a 1 week checkup to see how I was doing. They asked me how I was doing emotionally, and I told my doctor, horribly. She then said, you know, it's very common for women to have to go on antidepressants temporarily to cope with this loss. I have thought a lot about this comment. I came home and told my husband what she said, and he responded with, you know, that's the problem with our society. Everyone wants a quick fix, and everyone wants you to be over it quickly. Don't they understand that it takes time to heal? And you have to mourn. I have a friend whose adult daughter died in a car accident. Her doctor immediately put her on antidepressants. I actually met her about 2 months after her daughter died and thought she seemed too well composed for the magnitude of the loss. About a year later, she demanded to be taken off the antidepressants, and you know what? She finally grieved her daughter's death. All the medication did was delay her grief. You're right, Dr. Laura. We have to feel all the feelings, not just the good ones. When someone dies or we lose them for some other reason, we grieve. And in the end, that process makes us stronger. As for me, I am thankful for the two girls I have been given. I don't understand why God took this littlest angel, and I will probably always wonder. Right now, I cry at night so my children won't have to watch me. I haven't gone a night without some tears. But I honestly would not want it any other way. My emotions and my tears validate that my baby was a person. Most people with time and support survive all sorts of outrageous fortunes. For those who ultimately can't, medical and psychological treatments may be helpful. I believe, though, that we should raise our children as we did in the past, with stories of strangers and notables overcoming adversity as motivation and role models. My Aunt Lucia, whom I've never met, is mine. My aunt and mother were very young women during World War II in fascist Italy under Mussolini. The Nazi SS were all over northern Italy, specifically Gorizia, their hometown. My Aunt Lucia joined the underground to fight with the Allies. Unfortunately, that rebel cell had been discovered by the SS, and the day Lucia joined, she was caught, lined up with others against a wall, and shot down. I heard this story when I was a very little girl. At the time I heard it, it had little meaning for me outside of an interesting story about my mom's past. As I grew up and experienced more and more confusion and pain in life, the story would come back to me time and again as if to hold my head above the water. I come from sterner stuff, I'd remind myself, than to cave in under this. I'd think of my aunt's willingness to put her life on the line to go up against murderous fascists and Nazis, and I'd be humbled and energized. Lisa's story brings up the issue of endurance. My dad was in World War II in Korea. My mom was in the British Army for 3 years. My mom's brother was a fireman who was killed in the bombings. I think one of the greatest things I learned from my parents is you do what you have to when you have to do it. My mom lived with bombs going off all around her, and my dad had to, among things, bring home the dead soldiers to their families. They didn't have time to collapse and think about how distraught they were. Things had to be done, and they did them. They didn't spend years on the psych's couch. No, I'm not knocking people who need therapy, but they just did what they had to do. Great life lesson for me. They were truly the greatest generation. Not everyone comes from a family with spirited and inspiring stories. Some of you grew up surrounded by perpetual sadness, anger, bitterness, and negativity, even about the good stuff. Of course, that will make it difficult for you to do other than what you've been indoctrinated into. Difficult does not mean impossible. First, you must have the awareness that embracing suffering is a learned response, a habit. Vanny came to that awareness, and it freed her to actually experience happiness without guilt or fear. She wrote, "Once I realized I wanted to just be happy instead of continuing the family pattern I had grown up with, I decided to shut up, do the right things, and focus on the blessings in my life instead of what was wrong. I believe happiness is a habit, not a circumstance. The two main things that have helped me make this transition in my life is my faith in God and my fight to always keep a positive attitude no matter what. I have to repeat myself, happiness is a habit." Let me express Vanny's point in another way. You know those ink blot pictures? Well, you can focus on the dark or you can focus on the light. Whichever you focus on will give you a different picture. You never stop being aware of the dark. In fact, you check it out quite carefully. But ultimately, you have the choice of which to use to discern the picture to report. Even if the light and dark are distributed 50-50, you still get to choose. Even if the dark overwhelms the light, you still get to choose. You've all seen movie scenes with the death of somebody absolutely beloved. Everyone is crying and suffering. One person says, "Well, at least she or he is no longer suffering," and we all have largely wonderful memories of a loving relationship that we can share with each other for the rest of our lives. Generally,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.